Good morning, everybody. Ooh, is this on? This is good test because I'm preaching later. Good morning, everyone. It's so great to have you joining us for worship today, the day after Christmas. I hope that y'all all had a wonderful time with your families. I invite you now to prepare your hearts for worship and feel free to look ahead through our bulletin for some of our readings or some of our hymns if you want to let the words kind of sink into your hearts. And I really encourage you all to sing out for joy today. Think about all of the wonderful energy that comes with Christmas and really use that to worship our Lord. So we invite you now to worship with us this morning.
Please join me in the call to worship. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? One thing I asked of the Lord, that will I seek after, to live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For he will hide me in his shelter in the day of trouble. He will conceal me under the cover of his tent. He will set me high on a rock. Hear, O Lord, and I cry aloud. Be gracious to me and answer me. Come, my heart says, seek his face. Your face, Lord, do I seek. Wait for the Lord. Be strong and let your heart take courage. Wait for the Lord.
Thank you.
Glory to you, Almighty God, for you sent your only begotten Son that we might have new life. Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ, for you became flesh and dwelt among us that we might become your people. Glory to you, Holy Spirit, for you direct and rule our lives. Glory to you, Almighty God, and to your Son, Jesus Christ, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
Hello. God is light, in him there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him while we are walking in darkness, we lie and do not do what is true. Let us know, draw near to God, and be honest about the darkness of our hearts. Will you join me in the prayer confession? God of grace and truth, in Jesus Christ you came among us as light shining in darkness. We confess that we have not welcomed the light or trusted the good news to be good. We have failed to be your agents of peace on earth. We have resisted your mighty rule in our lives. We have been reluctant to glorify and praise you for becoming God with us. We have closed our eyes to your glory in our midst, expecting little and hoping for less. Forgive our doubt and renew our hope so that we may receive the fullness of your grace and live in the truth of Christ the Lord. Amen.
If we walk in the light as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ we are forgiven. O Lord, open our lips, and our mouths shall show forth your praise.
Thank you.
Because Jesus has shown his light into the darkness, we are at peace with God and we are at peace with one another. The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
What a wonderful day to gather and offer our praise, our worship to God. I think this might be the best sequence of how the calendar rolls around, to have Christmas on Saturday, our wonderful service this Christmas Eve on Friday evening, and then this day to come back to God's house and offer our praise and our thanks to God. It's a joy to welcome you all here, to welcome as well those who join us by means of electronic communication as South Highland offers praise to God. For those of you who are home from school or work or other places, we're delighted that you joined with us as well as any one of you who just wandered in because you saw the door was unlocked today. We're glad you're at South Highland. If you would take a moment and sign the friendship pads, let us know that you share in worship today. That would be most helpful. We have had such a glorious Advent and Christmas celebration. Hearty thanks to all those who have helped in so many, many ways, our wonderful musicians, our floral guild who have beautified these spaces, all the ways you have given of yourself, both in terms of your love and your care, your financial gifts. Thank you so much. We are being the church, and for that we're most grateful. Please note that we do have some limited hours this week as far as the regular office hours and things like that, and next week as well we just have the one service. Dr. Larry Michael will be preaching and encourage you to join us for that as well. We do extend our prayers and our sympathy to Dana Waters IV on the death of his friend Cindy Bailey. Her services were last week. Also to Mary Utloud upon the death of her husband of many years, Herb. Many of you who've been here for some time remember Mary and Herb. They were very active in the church. When I first came here, Mary was the clerk of session, and she really kept the records. She would show up at 9 o'clock the next day after a session meeting, typed up minutes for me to proof. Remember Mary, and we give thanks for the, Herb's life among us and his welcome into God's kingdom. Let us now continue to worship God.
Please join me in our prayer for illumination. Heavenly Father, we gather to worship this morning because we long to see Jesus. And as we read your word, we pray that by the power of your Holy Spirit, you would open our eyes to see his glory and to see your truth more clearly, and that your truth would set us free. We ask all these things in the strong and matchless name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Our scripture reading this morning is a little bit different today. We're going to be reading from Genesis 1, also John 1. And so I'll be reading the sections from Genesis, and Abby will be reading the sections from John. Listen carefully, for this is God's word. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God.
The earth was a formless void.
All things came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being.
And darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters.
What has come into being in him was life.
And then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light.
And the life was the light of all people.
And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness.
The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Will you all pray with me again, please? Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for sending your light into this world. God, I pray now that as I proclaim your word to your people, that it would not be my words, Lord, that anything that people walk out remembering today would be your message, not mine. God, I thank you for using weak vessels to speak your truth and power, and I ask that you would show up for us today this morning. I ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, it's so good to see all of you guys. I hope y'all had a wonderful Christmas filled with friends, family, or at least just a day off from the regular routine. I don't know if y'all watched a lot of Christmas movies, but Court and I didn't watch any this year, I don't think. I couldn't really think of any. Instead, we did a lot of Harry Potter. We watched all three Lord of the Rings, and I even went to go see the new Spider-Man movie, which I hope some of y'all have been able to do. And it sort of hit me that all of these stories really are the same in a lot of ways. It's all the story of light versus darkness. And why is it that we end up telling the same story over and over again in our great epics? I think it's because all of us have this story embedded deep in our hearts, because this is our story. We are drawn to stories of light versus darkness. And at least for me, I devour them just with this cautious hope that this is true, that the light will overcome the darkness, and that in the end, darkness will be destroyed. So in this passage that Court and I just read for us today, it is this great once upon a time woven together. And in the creation story, in the beginning of Genesis, we're reminded not necessarily how things all started, but really more of who is this God that we serve? Well, we're reminded that we serve a God who takes chaos and puts it in order. We serve a God who takes this emptiness and this void and fills it with beauty. We serve a God who separates lightness from darkness. And then in John's gospel, John does something poetic and powerful. He retells the Genesis story of creation, and he places Jesus at the center of it. Jesus was there creating everything. And what's so powerful and profound about weaving these passages together? I think in doing so, we realize that Jesus is Yahweh, that Jesus is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Jesus is the one who saved his people from Egypt. He is the God of the Old Testament. He is the God of the New Testament. And we discover that there is no separating. In school, you learn in history dates in terms of BC or AD, and it's before Christ or some Latin term for in the year of our Lord. But thanks to John's gospel, we know that there's no date in history that was before Christ. Jesus was there at the very beginning. Later today in our service, we're going to be affirming our faith not through the Apostles' Creed like we normally do, but in the Nicene Creed. And some of y'all might just think, oh, that's that longer one we have to do on Communion Sundays. And maybe, sure, that's part of it. But I chose that today because the language is actually a little bit more helpful. It's a gift to us from our ancient fathers and mothers in the faith that helps us explain sort of these confusing terms about what it means that Jesus is God. Jesus was not created, but everything is created through Christ. So I hope that as we proclaim that together later today, you can see these terms and that it'll help you have the vocabulary for it. The Trinity can be pretty complicated. Understanding what it means that Jesus is fully God and fully man can be pretty complex. One time in youth Sunday school, I made a great handout, I thought, and passed it out. And Henry Gilchrist took one look at it and handed it back to me and said, "My head hurts. I can't look at this anymore." Honestly, I told him, I'm right there with you. Because the Trinity is a great mystery of our faith. It's something that we can look at over and over again many different times, and we won't understand it. Part of me thinks that we're going to spend the rest of eternity trying to understand it, that we're not going to just get to heaven and instantly know. But it's because it's so beautiful and profound. So why does it matter? Why does it matter that we try to understand as much as we can? Why do we open God's word and read about what it means that Jesus is God? Well, because if Jesus is God, then the God who created trees allowed himself to be killed on one. The God who separated lightness from darkness allowed himself to be consumed by darkness. We'd much rather think of Jesus as this holy man who was meek and mild and always had the right thing to say when people tried to trip him up. We think that because of the cross, God, the Father, is this wrathful, vengeful God that can only be satisfied by the blood of his Son, and that Jesus is sort of this innocent victim. But the Bible tells us that's not true. The Bible tells us that God himself died on the cross, that God himself willingly put himself in our place. On Christmas Eve, just two nights ago, or one night, I don't know, we read one of my favorite passages from the Bible, from the book of Titus. And just to recap, it says, when Christ appeared on earth, the world finally got to see God in his glory. Because before then, no one had ever seen God. The book of Colossians tells us that Christ is the image of the invisible God. In other words, if you want to know who God is, look at Jesus. We can't separate Jesus from God. Jesus is God. God is Jesus. Jesus was there at the beginning, separating the light from the darkness. Jesus was at the beginning, filling the empty void with the most beautiful acts of creation you can imagine. And friends, this is what he still does for us today in our lives. So at creation, we see how God takes a mess, how he takes emptiness, and he creates the beauty of the world. So I'd like to tell you that even now, he is taking your mess, he is taking your emptiness, and he is filling it with beauty. At the incarnation, when Jesus is God, when God becomes man, we see how God moves into the darkness and he infuses it with light. And so, even now, he is invading the darkness in your life, in our world, and he's bringing light. And when he comes back at the reconciliation of all things, Jesus will defeat evil once and for all. And here's the beauty of the gospel. All of this is true, whether we see it, whether we feel it, whether we believe it or not. This is what Jesus is doing because this is who he is. This is his character. This is his nature. And this is the story that he's been telling from Genesis to Revelation. And this is our story too. In The Lord of the Rings, in the final battle of Gondor, for those of you that know what I'm talking about, there's this moment where everyone realizes that the good is going to win, the tide of the battle has turned, and I've always felt so bad for the people on the other side of the battlefield where victory hasn't quite made it over there yet. And so you have people that are fighting the enemy because the enemy knows they're going to lose, and they're trying to take out as many people as they can on their way down. I just always thought that would be so frustrating to see your salvation on the horizon, to know that it's happening over here, but it hasn't quite gotten there yet. And when I was watching this past weekend, I realized, oh my gosh, that's where we are in the story. Because we know that our victory is sure. We know that Christ is going to be victorious at the end of the age. We know that he already has defeated.
Join me now as we affirm our faith using that ancient creed, that most universal creed of all the church throughout the earth, throughout history, the Nicene Creed. Let us say together what we believe. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated on the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness. Lead all nations in the way of justice and goodwill. Direct those who govern, that they may rule fairly, maintain order. Uphold those in need and defend oppressed peoples, that this world may claim your rule and know your true peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Awaken all people to the danger we have inflicted upon the earth. Implant in each a reverence for all you have made, that we may preserve the delicate balance of creation for all coming generations. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give grace to all who proclaim the gospel through word and sacrament and deeds of mercy, that by their teaching and example, they may reveal your love for all people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Comfort and relieve, O Lord, all who are in trouble, sorrow, poverty, sickness, grief, especially those known to us, whom we now name before you in silence. We particularly remember this day, O Lord, Robert, Thurman, and Linda, Judy, and Ashley, and Clint. We pray for your comforting spirit to be close to Dana Waters IV upon the death of his friend Cindy, with Mary Utlout upon the death of her husband Herb. Heal us all, O God, in body and mind or circumstance, working in us and in these for whom we pray by your grace, wonders beyond all they may dream or hope. Lord, in your mercy, bring to our remembrance all who, having served you on earth, now sing your praises eternally. May their endurance give us courage, and their faithfulness give us hope. We praise you, O God, for Jesus, who came to save us from our sins. We thank you for the hope of the prophets, the song of the angels, and the birth of Jesus in Bethlehem. We thank you that in Jesus you became flesh and dwelt among us, sharing human hurts and pleasures. Glory to you for your grace-filled love. Glory to you, eternal God, through Jesus Christ, Lord of lords and King of kings, now and forever, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We're grateful to have our college students that are assisting today in worship, and appreciate very much your ongoing participation in the life of your home church.
Just as Christ offered for our sakes freely, we are now invited to offer ourselves to reflect his light. We're not passing the offering plate today, but we have two plates as you exit the building over there.
To walk as a child of the light, I want to follow Jesus. God sent the stars to give light to the world. The star of my life is Jesus. And the day are both alike. The Lamb is the light of the city of God. Shine in my heart, Lord Jesus. I want to see the brightness of God. I want to look at Jesus. Clear sun of righteousness, shine on my path and show me the way to the darkness at all. The night and the day are both alike. The Lamb is the light of the city of God. Shine in my heart, Lord Jesus. I'm looking for the coming of Christ. I want to be with Jesus. When we have
have run with patience the race, we shall know the joy of Jesus. In him there is no darkness at all. The night and the day are both alike. The Lamb is the light of the city of God. Shine in my heart, Lord Jesus.
Please pray with me. God of mystery and might, we praise and worship you, for you came in silence while all lay sleeping to enter our world as a child of humble birth. We thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, born of your servant Mary. In his face we behold your glory, for in his life, as in his death, is your gift of salvation. By your Spirit, make our hearts burn with thanksgiving, that we may give as we have received. Let our whole lives be gifts of praise to you, God of love and peace. In your gracious name of Jesus Christ, your Son, by the power of your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
friends, I send you out into this from this place into the world with this message of hope and peace and this blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you his peace, both now and forevermore. Amen.